Hello, we're going to look at trace tables in this video, which can catch people out in paper two. They're not always a student's favorite thing to get faced with, but they are very doable once you have some practice. So what does a trace table involve? It involves you going through either an algorithm or a program line by line, and you're almost pretending like you are the computer. You've got to follow the code or follow the flowchart step by step. And it's a table, a trace table. So it has columns. The columns can really be anything that can change in a program. So don't get too thrown by what you are given. Normally it will give you an empty table and it will sort of label the columns already. You just have to use what it gives you to complete. So typically there'll be variables. You might also get items in an array. You might also get a for loop counter. You might also get an output column. You might also get a line number column. It really varies what exactly you'll get, but it generally are things which will change in your program, because change is really why we are doing trace tables. Because what we do is we write down a value whenever the value changes in our program. If things stay the same, it's not really worth us keeping track of. We're tracking what changes are being made as our program is processing. The reason why we use trace tables is, well, we want to potentially find out what an algorithm does. That's why they might put it in paper two. Because a follow-up question might be, oh, what does this actually do? Code can be confusing. You actually doing the code yourself and tracing it can make it easier to understand what it's actually doing. But also, in real life, you may use a trace table, because if you have a really tough logic error, you can't understand what's happening. You might manually go through the code line by line to try and find out what this logic error is. The idea is that because you are writing down every time a value changes, you might notice when it first starts going wrong. Okay, let's have a look at an example. So what is going on here? Well, we've got some code on the left-hand side. This is in OCR ERL. We've got a do until loop in the middle. You wouldn't see this in Python, but it is in ERL. And I've got a almost empty table on the right-hand side, which is typically what you'd be given in an exam. So they've pre-populated the columns and they've also filled in a value or two. Often it will start the trace table off for you, in particular, if there is some input, because you can't read their mind, you need to be able to know what the input is, and so they might fill it in for you or mention it in the question. So what do I do? Well, I look at my columns. What have I got here? I've got the line number. This is used occasionally in exams, not always, but I've also got num. Num is a variable in my code, so is total. Num is less than or equal to zero isn't a variable. This is a Boolean expression. So this is coming from our loop. It's the condition in our do until loop. So this is either going to be true or false. They occasionally put these in as well. I need to go through my code and every time a value changes, write it down. Well, line one has been done for us because we are effectively being told the input is 3.5. But in line two, the total is equal to zero. So I fill in those because the line number and total have changed. Nothing else has changed at this point. Line three, nothing's happening. And a rule of trace tables is I only write stuff down if something is happening. If nothing's happening, if nothing's changing, I don't do anything. So line three, I don't do anything. Line four, I don't do anything because the do word doesn't do anything, ironically. But line five, we are assigning a new variable. So I will write stuff down here. So total is being set to total plus num, or total is currently zero. I'm adding num to total. Zero plus 3.5 is going to be 3.5. So the new value of total is 3.5. In line six, num is set to num minus one. So num is currently 3.5, minus one is 2.5. And now, because a do until loop has the condition at the end, I'm now reaching my condition in my loop. So this is where our Boolean expression is coming in. So therefore I will write line seven here. Despite this line not actively doing anything, because this is in my trace table, I do have to take it into account. So what is num less than or equal to zero? Well, num is 2.5. 2.5 is not less than or equal to zero. So therefore, this as an expression is false. Do until loops keep looping until the condition is true. So because it's false, I'm going to loop back to line five. And the total, we're going to add num to it. So the total is currently 3.5 plus 2.5 is going to be six. It's that column I'm changing. And in line six, we are again subtracting one from num. So 2.5 becomes 1.5. On line seven, 1.5 is still not less than or equal to zero. So therefore the condition is still false. Now, I'm going to write down false here because despite false not changing, I am back to this line. I am looking at it. It is still evaluating this new value. So despite this column now not changing, I am still going to write it down because I am doing an operation with a new value. Like before, it was 2.5. Now it's 1.5. It's a new value. It has to be run again. That's why I'm going to write down a value there. Okay, now I'm at line 7. It's still false. So I go back up to line 5. I add total to num. So this is now 7.5. On line 6, I'm subtracting 1 again. So this is now 0.5. My condition is now still, well, I say now, the condition is still false because 0.5 is not smaller than or equal to 0. But we're getting close, clearly. And you've got to be careful not to get too carried away. You've still got to follow the code really, really carefully. Don't be tempted to skip ahead or guess what's happening. We're going back up to line 5 here. So total is total plus num. 7.5 plus 0.5 is 8. On line 6, num is equal to num minus 1. So now we're going to minus 0.5. And our condition on line 7, well, now minus 0.5 is smaller than 0. So therefore, our condition is now true. And because it's a do until loop, because my condition is true, it now is done with this loop. And we jump down to line 8, nothing's here, and line 9, where we're going to print the total. So 8 would get printed if this code run. Now, I deliberately didn't put in a column for output. Often there will be a column for output, but let's imagine the examiner decided not to put in one. Well, we're not going to invite ourselves to do a new column. We just stick to the trace table given to us. Here there was no output, so I don't need to do anything else. This would be my final answer. And I totally get if you're thinking, this is so confusing. When you look at it and you're done, it's very confusing. And admittedly, as I'm going through it, it might be confusing as well. If you think you understand it, that's great. But if you're finding it hard, that's quite normal. I would suggest you go back a few minutes when it was empty again, have a go on paper and see if you can come up with the same answer I did. If you can, that's obviously a good sign. Okay, let's have a look at a second example then. And again, perhaps have a go if you think you need to have a bit of practice. So we're given 5 columns this time. I'm given nothing in the table itself. You need to just read the columns and then process is always the same. You go through it top to bottom, line by line. Don't skip ahead. Don't make predictions. Just go like a robot through the code. Now, the first two lines we are assigning to arrays, to variables, but nothing's changing in my table. None of the columns are relevant here. So lines 1 and 2, I don't do anything. Number of rooms, however, is in my table and I initialize this variable to be 4. So I write down 4 in number of rooms. And spare is set to be 0 here. Now, I have not, this time round, been asked to keep track of our line numbers. So because of this, I've got a bit more freedom in what I want to do here. I could either write the 0 here or I could write the 0 here. I wouldn't do both because I wouldn't copy a value down for no good reason. But I could put it in either one of those positions. Now, personally, if I'm not being forced to write down line numbers, I would rather we put the 0 on the same line as the 4, which might not seem particularly logical if you've just seen the example I just gave you where we did have line numbers. However, in my head at least, these two lines are pretty much in the same region of code. They're the same block of code. They can therefore go in the same position. The sequencing of these two lines is not important. Therefore, putting it on the same line is not a problem. We're now entering a for loop where, in my head, this is now a separate block of code. We've now got a kind of single block here to enter. And so I'm keeping track of, I is initially 0 in my for loop. I'd put this 0 down here to differentiate from the top block of code. Now, number of rooms minus 1, we're not actually subtracting 1 from number of rooms. We're just using it to work out how many times this is going to loop. But it might be worth mentally calculating, well, number of rooms is 4, minus 1 is 3. So really, this is 3. So I is going to reach 3, and then it's going to stop. Okay, now we are entering this difference line of code here. So difference equal to max capacity index. Well, initially I is 0. So initially this is index 0, minus current capacity, also index 0. So what is max capacity index 0? Well, it's 35. And current capacity index 0 is 15. So I'm doing 35 minus 15, which is 20. So difference is going to be set to be 20. Again, personally, because it's in the same block of code, I would put it on the same line, but you might decide to do it on a separate line. That's really your judgment call. There's no correct answer there. And I'll move on to this if statement. So if the difference is less than or equal to 4, then I'm going to print something, but 20 is obviously nowhere near less than or equal to 4. So I skip this if statement and I go instead to this line here where spare is being set to the old value of spare plus the difference. So spare should now be 0 plus 20, which is just 20. Again, I'm on putting it on the same line. That's how I'd personally decide to do it. Okay, now I've started to kind of doodle on my page here a little bit to keep track of workings. I would do this if it's a slightly trickier trace table. You might get confused in future goes, so you might want to cross out stuff as you go. Let me just erase it. Well, we're going back up to the top of our for loop. Next I means we're adding 1 to I, so I is now 1. And so we're now looking at max capacity index 1 minus current capacity index 1. So really, the difference is going to be 45 minus 42, which is now 3. Now this time round, difference 3 is less than or equal to 4. We are going to run this print line. That's what the output column is for. Output is representing print. So we are going to write warning in, then I plus 1, where I is currently 1. We're going to do warning in 2, therefore. Because there is no else, I don't skip the spare line. I still have to go down to the spare line. I'm doing spare plus difference. So 20 plus 3 is now 23. So I go back up to the top of my for loop. I hasn't reached 3 yet, so I'm not going to start thinking about finishing it. I is now going to be equal to 2. The difference is going to be now 35 minus 30, which is 5. And 5 is not less than or equal to 4, so I don't run the print line again. I just do the spare addition. So spare is 23 plus 5 is 28. And I go back round. I is now 3. Now, the way for loops work in OCR ERL is they are inclusive. So this value here, we are going to include. Once I hit 4, we're going to stop. So really, this is my last iteration, is what I'm trying to say. Well, at index 3, we've got 20 minus 18, which is 2 as our difference. This is less than or equal to 4. So we're going to print out this warning again. This time I is 3. So it's going to be warning in 4, which gets output. And the spare line, we're adding the difference to the old value of spare. 28 plus 2 is 30. And because of this bit here equaling 3, I am done with my for loop at least. I'm not done with my trace table, but I'm done with my for loop because we've covered 3 as I, it's now 4, therefore I'm done. I'm sure you figured out what this is doing roughly. It's going through our two arrays, finding the difference between each of the items at the same index and printing a warning if it is a number less than or equal to 4. But we're not done because I've got a final line outside of my for loop where I'm printing spare. Printing is outputting, therefore I've got to print what spare is. Spare is currently 30, so I'm going to print 30, and that's it. That's my trace table done. I have gaps like I always do because we don't always have stuff changing in every place. I've grouped it based on it being in the same block. You won't always be given loads and loads of space. That's partly why I like to group changes, because if you aren't being told to give line numbers, it might be quite tight on space. And so grouping code within the same block together on one line can save you space. But if you need more lines, that's fine. Just get extra paper in the exam, and that's not a huge deal. But it's good to try and stick to their table if you are able to.